feel like we've lifted off the ground just a little bit. And we are so grateful for everybody being here. We're in a process of trying to rebuild this congregation. We have a daycare that's full of people during the week, but we've got to focus now on the congregation to see if we can get the congregation up, and we're believing God to help us do that. So we're always excited when we come together and we have friends to come and join us. Before some of you were born, there was a Frenchman named Charles Blondin. Charles Blondin was a tightrope walker, and he walked a wire across Niagara Falls. Some of us are more familiar with people like Evel Knievel in our time period, but this guy was sort of that type of person, very daring. So he goes for this event at Niagara Falls, and there's people on both sides, a crowd is there. And so he asked the crowd, "Do you believe that I can push this wheelbarrow across this wire and walk behind it?" And everybody cheered him on and said, "Will you believe you can do that?" And he had quite a reputation. So Charles Blondin, the Frenchman, gets that wheelbarrow, puts it on the wire, and assembles himself behind it on the same wire. And he pushes that wheelbarrow across Niagara Falls, walking behind it. And then when he got to the other side of the crowd, he spoke to them and said, "Now, how many believes that I can put somebody in the wheelbarrow and go back across?" And everybody said, "Well, yeah, you know, who'll be a volunteer?" It got very quiet, very quiet. Nobody at that point in moment in time was willing to test that out. Except after a few moments of silence, a little boy, 11, 12 years old, raised his hand and said, "I'll do it." So everybody's aghast, you know, who is this kid? Maybe he don't know any better what he's doing, you know. So he gets into the wheelbarrow, they hoist it up on the wire, and Charles Blondin gets behind the wheelbarrow with the little boy in the wheelbarrow, and he begins to go back across Niagara Falls. And everybody's just, you know, so tense watching this. And he makes it across. He makes it across. And everybody's cheering on both sides. They're cheering for this great feat that Charles Blondin did. And everybody wanted to rush to this little boy. "Who are you? Why would you raise your hand and do such a thing?" And it was such an incredible, inspiring punchline to this story. When I read it, it just touched me deeply. The little boy told this crowd, "He's my father. And when you know your father, when you know your father, you can do such things as that." Listen, whenever faith and unbelief meet, there's going to be war. Whenever faith and unbelief meet, there's going to be conflict. The big question is, what side are you going to take in this war, in this conflict of faith and fear, or faith and unbelief? I went and saw a movie one time, and the price of the ticket was worth this one phrase, one thing in the movie. It was worth it for that one thing that I heard. And it was this: there comes times in our lives where there is a moment in time where we have to stand up and be men and women of God. We have to stand up and define the moment. Right then, you don't have much time. You've got to stand up and define the moment. And if you don't, if you just sit there on your blessed assurance, the moment will pass. And the thing that's telling, the moment will define you. So it boils down to this. There's times when God allows circumstances to come, and by faith, we've got to stand up. Pony up. Man up. Whatever way you want to say it. We've got to stand up and define the moment by faith. Otherwise, we sit there in unbelief and fear, and the moment passes forever. But that moment defines us if we don't define it. What side are you going to take? 1 Corinthians 16:13. Watch ye, stand fast in the faith. One translation makes it a little bit maybe clearer. Stand firm in your faith. Be courageous, be strong. I like one translation said, keep on acting like men. Continue to grow in strength. Amen. Stand firm in your faith. We need people this day and time to stand firm. As Brother Ed led us, stand firm for your family, for your city, for your church, for your grandkids. We need God to give us that strong spiritual backbone to stand firm. Be courageous. Be strong. Continue to grow in strength, in faith, in grace, and in the knowledge of God. You cannot play with unbelief. We must avoid unbelief at all costs. You can't play with that. Unbelief is a bandit. It acts like a bandit. It will rob us of everything, every time, anywhere. Unbelief steals and robs from us. We've got to be very concerned about unbelief. Hebrews 4:1 says, let us therefore fear unbelief. So he goes on and says, so let us fear that a promise of entering into his rest, we miss it. How many here want to join Pastor Dave and say, you don't want to miss what God has? We don't want to miss it. We're trying to believe God to save this church. We don't want to miss it. God wants to take us, and he wants to use us. He wants to do something miraculous here. He really does. Let us fear that a promise that God gives us of entering into his rest. He's speaking of the children of Israel. They couldn't enter into his rest. They go back and look. They could not enter the promised land because they would not. They could not because they simply would not. Unbelief is a destroyer. It blinds the eyes. It dulls the imagination. I come up with a real funny word here. I've never used it, but I thought it was cool. It stupefies the conscience. It makes us insensitive to what's going on around us. It causes lethargy in our life. Unbelief is a destroyer. Dulls the imagination, blinds the eyes. I like the quote that faith is the eye that can see the invisible. Amen? I think I read somewhere, if I correctly give it to you, that Einstein said imagination is a very powerful thing. He said imagination is a preview of life's coming attractions. Now unto him that is able to do exceeding and abundant above all that you think or ask, and the amplified above what you can even imagine. How many here have a good imagination? Now that's good. Yeah, good imagination. And I like that. God's able to do above and beyond even what we can imagine in our wildest dreams. Einstein, imagination is a preview of life's coming attractions. When my parents, when I was really little, and they talked about, and this is going way back before some of us were born, Buck Rogers, space travel. And it was so far-fetched. It was so unbelievable. It was so much fantasy. But yet, in a lifetime, from Buck Rogers' beginning to the old age of men who saw Buck Rogers as young men, they actually saw it come to pass. Unbelief is a destroyer. It dulls our imagination. God wants us to start believing for impossible things beyond what we could ever even imagine. Unbelief and pessimism is like gravity. It will pull you down to the ground. How many of you have ever experienced that? I mean, you can get down real quick. And I tell you what, I was so lifted up last night. We was just going, looking at the news, and all of a sudden, the first lady walks out on this stage before 9,000 people in Florida. And you know, she's a beautiful lady and seems very nice person. I mean, she comes off that way. But boy, what really impressed the life out of me, she walks up to the stage before 9,000, and I don't know how many thousands out that couldn't get in. And she led that place in the Lord's Prayer. I thought, man, there's hope for America, maybe. Maybe there's some hope. We sit there and start crying. I mean, when is the first lady ever got up before thousands of people and led the Lord's Prayer? I don't remember anybody doing it. It was moving. I mean, whatever our politics are, you got to be moved by that. Listen, nothing can punish us more than miss opportunities. I have a book. Have I brought it with me? I think I did. Yeah, I did. Mark Batterson. Everybody in here needs to read this book. It'll change your life. It's called One Word, Two Letters, If. Everybody say if.
If.
That's an awful small word, right? But it has unbelievable consequences. In his book, he said, are we going to be the what-if people of possibilities? Are we going to be the what-if people of possibilities? Are we going to be the if-only people of regret? Can I say that one more time? The whole book is about that. Are we going to be what-if people of possibilities? Are we going to be if-only people of regrets? I gotta tell you, I won't tell you my stories where I goofed up, but I will tell you a few stories where some things were good that happened. I brought my object lesson today. Now, what does this have to do with the message? Well, it has a lot. This was a particular time that I went out on a limb in faith to believe God. We were trying to start Teen Challenge in Moore County. And it was, we were in court 6 months, and we went through so much trying to start the youth program for drug rehabilitation. And I bought the property with a $100 bill, and it was just crazy. And a lease purchase option, and we went with so many things that took place. But I had this dream about bringing somebody here to Moore County to help get Teen Challenge started. And I don't know if you can read this or not. Can you tell me the name that you read on there?
No.
I'll find somebody that can make read. You need the gift of interpretation. How many knows who the greatest star of the Globetrotters was? Sign this ball for me, because I flew him and his entire team from California, and I can't begin to tell you how much money I had to come up with. A lot of Yes, I don't even want to have to tell you that, because you might get depressed if I tell you how much I had to come up with. I did. I got depressed over it myself. Especially when it wasn't coming in real quick. We brought metal arc lemon. Businessman came through for me. We brought him to Moore County and his team from California. We went to high schools, gymnasiums, and did exhibition games with his team. And one of the high schools we went to, the referee didn't show up. I had to put on a striped suit and be a referee. I thought I was going to have a heart attack going up and down that court. It was unbelievable. I have a lot more respect for those people now that do the refereeing. Especially basketball. It was an adventure of faith, I want to tell you. But let me tell you, we went to all the high schools, and he would go in the high school gym, and he'd do a hook shot, go through the girders, half court now, half court. He'd throw that ball over his shoulder, go through the girders, because he had to go that high with the arc, and watch that ball go right through the net. And he did it very consistently. He was considered one of the greatest ball handlers ever to live. God called him into ministry after his great fame that he acquired. We had him at the church one night of that time period, and I was able to get the entire, or at least most of the entire marching band from the high school. I went to the high school and said, I want the marching band to come to hear Metal Arc Lemon. And I want them to play their music. Well, the band director said, well, preacher, we don't play gospel music. I said, I know. I said, tell me what you play. He said, we play songs about winning. I said, we need that too. Hey! So he said, I can't make them come, but I'll encourage them, and I can't force them. But I said, I want them to come in full uniform. That night, Metal Arc, we were on the stage. We had a stage set up for, especially set up for Metal Arc Lemon. Those kids came down that aisle when church started in full dress uniform, came up to the front and played all their songs, then sat down. Metal Arc began to minister. At the close of the service, 30-plus band members were the first to come down to the altar. Sometimes you got to do something. Sometimes you got to step out in faith and do the impossible. I didn't know how I was going to pay for it. I was worried about even being able to pay for it. And it was a struggle. But nothing can punish us more than missed opportunities. In Hebrews 3:17-18, speaks of Israel's history, early history, and what unbelief cost them. God had a plan to bring them into the promised land. But they look back, and Hebrews looks back on the history of that and said they missed it. They wandered in the desert for all those years. 40 years they wandered around the same mountain. Listen, God wants to shake us up. He wants us to stand up and define the moment for what He's put us in. Yes. Nothing's worse than the punishment of missed opportunities. The disciples who stayed in the boat, you know, Jesus said, well, come on out here. Peter, come on out. You know what the other disciples were doing in the boat? Yeah, Peter, get on out there. You go on out there and walk on that water. Now, they ain't going to do it for nothing. But they're going to encourage Peter, yeah, you go out there and walk on that water. Listen, after he walked and then he did a little sinking and God pulled him back up, what do you think those other disciples were thinking? Man, what a missed opportunity to walk out to the Savior and be a part of a miracle. What I missed! I missed! George Mueller of Bristol, England, he didn't miss any opportunities. When you Read the story of George Mueller. It is so inspiring. He had the faith that God would enable him to feed and care for 2,000 orphans every day without going after public or private money. He believed that God... There were times, I may have mentioned, when he would have all the kids gather around the table, the plates were there, the forks and knives were there, the spoons were laid out, and there was no food in the cupboard, no food in the kitchen, and he had those children to line up and sit at the table and tell them to pray over their meal, even though there was not one bit of food in the building. And while they're praying, bowing their heads over empty plates, trucks would pull up in the kitchen. I mean, at least God can supply.
Yes.
Jesus said, have faith in God. We've got to lay aside our unbelief and our doubts, and we have to get back to those words. Have faith in God. It'll get you out of the boat, and it may get you into a wheelbarrow. Because you know your Father, and you know who He is. If you know your Father, you've got to know His ability. Genesis 18:4. Sarah laughed when God said, you're going to have a baby, daughter. You're going to have a baby. But both of them were past childbearing age. This is like going out to the nursing home and tell some old woman that she's going to have a baby. The Bible says Sarah laughed because they were past the age of parenthood. But verse 4 of Genesis 18 was a divine word from God to Sarah. It was a divine word for her. And the word was, is there anything too hard for the Lord? And I speak that to you and your church and your family and your grandkids. Is anything too hard for the Lord? No! Because you know your Father's ability. Ephesians 3:20. Now to Him that is able to do exceeding and abundant above all that we ask or think or even imagine, according to His power that works through just ministers. No. Us. Somebody say us. Just us. Aren't you glad God works through just ordinary people? I'm about as ordinary as you can get, people. I'm scared when I try to step out and do stuff. I'm just about as ordinary as they come. But I want to tell you, God will touch people. When I first started preaching, I couldn't even find the books of the Bible. I had to write the number of the page down to get to the book. Because I had a hard time with trying to remember all the books. So in my first years of preaching, I just write the number of the page. The only problem was I had to make sure I had the right Bible. Because numbers don't work the same if you change Bibles. You get in trouble. I never forget. I did public schools here in California, and I would go to do a public school, and I was speaking to thousands a day. And these PTA and people would take me out for lunch. Well, where did you go for orientation and learning how to speak? I said, well, no, I didn't take any lessons on speaking. You didn't take any lessons on public speaking? No. It was the anointing of God is where it came from. That really flipped him out. You know your Father's ability. Luke 1:37 says, for with God nothing is impossible. Luke 1:37. For with God nothing shall be impossible. And you got to know your Father's availability. Isaiah 41:10. This has got such progression. Say progression. This has got such progression. And it's just like God's getting closer and He's reaching out. He's reaching out to us. It just, the progression is just amazing. He says, listen, I am with you. Fear not, I am with you. How many knows that would be enough most of the time? I am with you. And then he says, be not dismayed. I am your God. Well, I'm ready to go home now. I'm good. But we keep going. What does he say? Fear not, I am with you. Be not dismayed, I am your God. I will strengthen you. Well, my gracious, it's definitely time to go home, right? Because look what he says, he's with us here. Then he goes on and says, I will help you. Okay, is that good? Yes. Okay, look there, look. I'm with you. I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. And then he just puts the cream on top of the cake. I will hold you up. Somebody say amen to God. Do you understand now why the little 12-year-old boy could get in his father's wheelbarrow? Because when you know your father and know his ability, you have no fear to get in the wheelbarrow. You have no fear to walk out of the boat and walk to Jesus. And then Psalms 121:4. He who keeps Israel. I said, he who keeps Israel shall neither slumber nor sleep. Somebody say amen. How many know 24/7 God is working in our lives? 24/7 He's working in us and for us and before us. He never slumbers nor sleep. Let me tell you what I heard a good testimony one time. This guy had a lot of stuff on him, a lot of stuff on his plate, and it was pretty heavy. And so he was having a hard time sleeping. So finally he came up with this. He said, God, I'm so tired. I have got to sleep. I'm reading the scriptures. You don't have to sleep. I have to sleep. So God, since you don't sleep and I need to sleep, I just put it all on you. And he went on to sleep. Sometimes we just got to do that. We've got to just cast all of our care upon him so we can get the rest that we need. Jeremiah 23:20, present help. Let me know he's a present help. You got to know your father's ability and his availability, and he's stable. How many know God is stable? You got to know your father's stability. For I am the Lord, I change not. It refers to the nature and the character of God that cannot change. The nature and the character of God cannot change. It said of Jesus, he's the same yesterday, today, and forever. I like Hebrews 13:8. He was, he is, he ever will be the same. Let's quote that together. He was, he is, he ever will be the same. Amen. Praise the Lord. Your father, you've got to know your father's dependability as well. 1 Kings 8:56. Blessed be the Lord who has given rest unto his people Israel according to all that he has promised. There has not failed one word of his good promise. And everybody said, amen. Amen. Is that true? I tell you what, you can depend on God. God is reliable and you can depend on him. The sun comes up, the sun goes down. The moon comes out, sometimes we see it, sometimes we don't, but it's still there. God never fails. He is dependable. As the sun goes and sun sets, day comes, winter comes, seasons come and go, God is faithful. At the last minute, I put this on the bottom of your sheet this morning. Fear releases the ability of Satan against us. I mean, you know what I'm talking about. Fear releases the ability of Satan against us. But faith releases the ability of God faith releases the ability of God on our behalf. I like what we quoted last week. Listen, after you fought one battle, you can't use the shells that you fought the last battle. It's time to lock and load and reload for the next battle. You gotta reload. Reload with the Word of God. Jesus came against Satan with the Word. And that's what we do as well. Amen? We do that. There's a poem that I thought was such a good poem. It says, if I find it, it'd be really nice, wouldn't it? There it is. And I'm going to give you this to put on your refrigerator with that other one put last week. The human spirit, once stretched by an adventure of faith, it never returns to the original size. The human spirit, once it's stretched by an adventure of faith, once you step out and do something as an adventure of faith and seek God's hand, seek God move, you never go back to the way you were before, ever. It's all changed. You'll never be the same again. I want to encourage every one of us today, myself included, let's believe God that He can help this church not only survive, but to thrive in the future. We have 40-something kids during the week. We need to build this congregation, and God's going to help us do it, because we're going to stand up and we're going to define the moment, and we're going to let God do something miraculous through us all. I believe that. Let's stand together, could we? And I want you, Mr. Ray, to crank it up like we're at a rock concert, okay?
Everything's gonna be alright.